church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is his new creation by water and the word. From him he came and sought her.
If you are the Son of God. The idea basically of placing doubt, or even for that matter, prove it.
Yeah,
prove it.
In essence, he's trying to plant doubt. And as I said, Jesus is on, it tells us he's walking on air, as the saying goes.
Mm-hmm. So, Jesus ends up answering him out of the book of Deuteronomy. He says, it is written, man shall not live on bread alone. Where is this taken from?
There are priorities, and we need to know what they are.
Take a look at Deuteronomy chapter 8 with me. And we'll start reading in verse 1, but where we're going is verse 3. Well, yeah, we're going to verse 3, but I may actually read down through about verse 5 or so. I just kind of like this section. It's really cool. This is Moses. He's saying, all the commands that I am commanding you today, you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land which the Lord swore to give to your forefathers. You shall remember all the way which the Lord your God has led you in the wilderness these 40 years, that he might humble you, testing you, to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. Did they pass that particular test, by the way? Not so well. Anyway. Verse 3, he humbled you and let you be hungry, and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor your fathers know, that he might make you understand that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by everything that proceeds out of the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing did not wear out on you, nor did your foot swell these 40 years. Thus you are to know in your heart that the Lord your God was disciplining you just as a man disciplines his son. So, looking at verse 3, and the latter part of verse 3, he says, he humbled you, let you be hungry, and fed you with manna, which you did not know. By the way, just as a piece of trivia, I think I've mentioned this back a number of months ago as we were going through a history of the Bible, of the Old Testament. Well, what does manna mean? What is this? That's what it means. What is this? Maybe we might have a shorter word for it. What's it? Or something. But in any case, yeah. They didn't know. It's known what it is to this day, except that it's something that landed on the ground like frost, and you could gather it up and make bread out of it, and so on and so forth. But the point, at least, is that he said, I tested you, I let you be hungry, so that I could give you manna, so that you would know what again? Man should not live by bread alone. Yeah. And more specifically to the point here, what he's trying to get across is that I was trying to teach you. You were afraid that you were going to die in the wilderness of hunger. But I provided for you everything, including miraculous bread. That's what this stuff was. It was miraculous bread. I provided this for you. So man, listen, folks, you weren't alive 40 years in the wilderness because of bread. You were alive in the wilderness 40 years because I provided for you because I said so. Because as long as my word says you're going to be living, you'll be living. I'll provide everything you need. That's why he goes on to say, take a look at your clothes. Got any holes? Your foot didn't even swell. But how did that happen? By the Lord's blessing. By the Lord doing something special for you. All right, taking that idea and now bringing it back over to what Jesus is saying, what's Jesus saying here? Yeah. You know, I've been fasting 40 days. And I haven't died yet. And maybe I am hungry. But I'm not going to be dying because God is blessing me. God is sustaining me. God is providing for me. I don't need to do that. That's kind of what he's saying here. I don't need it. God is providing for me.
Well, the wording it says here, I think, is misleading. And it said when this had ended, he became hungry.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mention that all along he had some substance.
Well, it says that he had been fasting for 40 days, right?
When you fast, do you eat something?
No, you do not. Well, it depends on the fast, I guess, but probably usually not.
If you're a human, you're going to get hungry before that 40 days is up. You're not going to wait until it's over to get hungry. It says here he did.
Mm-hmm. And what would that tell us?
Well, it was misleading because I don't believe that.
Well,
but this other reading would lead you to believe he did.
I've personally fasted some, not nearly 40 days, but I've fasted before. You know, the interesting thing is that whenever you first start fasting, okay, you do get hungry, but interestingly enough, after a while, you're not hungry anymore.
So. You realize he was hungry when it was over, but I believe mm-hmm.
He might have been hungry at first.
He might have felt some hunger.
Probably so. But I think the reason it's making mention of it is that the end of all this, that he was hungry, I think what he's trying to say is that if you've been fasting 40 days and suddenly you become hungry, how hungry do you suppose you might be?
I'd be
Or for the sake of Cleve, who just came to us from New England, wicked hungry, okay?
The explanation is in his answer.
Yeah.
And so it kind of clears it up, but I mm-hmm. think the writing here is a little bit misleading if you take this literally.
Well, and I do. I think he probably did get hungry at the first few days, but after that, probably not so much. Yeah, well, it actually does. I've talked to other people that have fasted with food before, and what they say is, yeah, the first 2 or 3 days, yeah, you are kind of hungry, but after that, I guess your metabolism or your insulin or who knows what's causing you to be hungry, just kind of levels out, and you just don't feel the hunger anymore. First couple of days, you're like, famished, but after that, maybe not so much. Anyway. Jesus is, go ahead, I'm sorry.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, there actually have been studies on people that are fasting, interestingly enough, when people go on hunger strikes and that kind of thing. And one of the interesting things is you actually can, you can go to 40 days, but after 40 days, there's usually bad things start happening.
Your body would react?
Well, your body starts eating its own organs is kind of what happens. Yes, sir?
Actually, just look at that. The first 5 to 7 days will be extreme hunger. And then after that, the hunger dissipates quite substantially. And after somewhere around 35 to 40 days, it starts to increase again. After a certain time after that, it becomes dangerous.
Yeah. So, in any case, giving what Jesus answered here, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And going back to Deuteronomy and understanding what Moses and what God was saying back at that particular point in time, what was the real temptation to Jesus? I mean, Jesus is being spoken to by Satan, make these stones into bread. Jesus is responding, man shall live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. That being said, what was the real temptation to Jesus? Yeah, it was about not depending upon God and providing for himself, doing for himself, and that apparently was the real temptation, as far as Jesus was concerned. You're calling upon me to not depend upon God, but I'm going to depend upon God because that's what the right thing to do is. That's right.
If you don't get hungry and you're human and possible human, mm-hmm.
Yeah. How does this end up having application to us, though? This temptation and Jesus' response to it.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. I think if Jesus has to leave everything he had as being the whole universe to himself, comes down and then come back and get everything, it wouldn't make any sense for him to come down at all.
Yeah.
And then secondly, as Jesus left everything behind, forgo all that Satan wanted to give it to him,
we'll get to that in just a second.
To your point here,
uh-huh.
we're like those Israelites in the desert or wilderness. Not everything in this life is rosy, and you know, we're provided 5-course meals every time we eat, or however you want it, whatever the example is. We do go through some tough times.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, in this situation, that's God leading us and showing us that we do need to rely on him and that we'll get through it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we can all look back on those tough times of our lives and we did get through them. And
what's the temptation whenever we go through hard times like that?
Well, especially if an easy solution's right in front of you that just gets you through, and it may not be what's best, but it's there.
May not even be legal, for that matter, or ethical, or anything else along that line.
Temptation when you're in those mm-hmm. weak moments is to just grab the easy fix.
Cut corners. I need to eat. I need to pay my mortgage. I need to fill in the blank, whatever it is. And it's going to be important for us to be able to rely on the Lord instead of relying upon our own personal fixes, because our own personal fixes don't always work out so swell. Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm. God.
Sure.
Continuously, because we fall into temptation.
Right.
So therefore, that's what he's trying to
Mm-hmm. So we have to depend on him to guide.
Right.
You know, because if we try to lead our own, we would lead ourselves into destruction.
All of history agrees with you. Yes, sir.
You know, there's just little things sometimes that end up really being the very most important. I think of two occasions Jesus talked about a man coming and to offer his sacrifice to God. Mm-hmm. And then he remembers that there is a wall that's been built between him and his brother.
Mm-hmm.
Now he doesn't say, you go ahead and finish up and then you go take. He said, no, you stop right where you are. Lay your gift right there by the altar and you go get reconciled to your brother. Then you come back.
Mm-hmm.
I think of Saul when he saved the fatted calf of the Amalekites.
Yeah.
And then he tries to offer the excuse to Samuel, well, we offered the best to sacrifice to God.
Mm-hmm.
And he offered him a real simple but profound principle. Which is the best? Which do you think God wants first? Does he want sacrifice or does he want obedience? Then he says, behold, to obey is better than sacrifice.
Right. Exactly so. So, the second temptation. What is
the first temptation, just at the end?
Sure.
2 Corinthians 3:5. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything as coming from us, but our sufficiency is from God.
Mm.
The temptation is the same. We look to ourselves instead of to God.
Exactly. Yeah. Good. Good scripture. Good point. The second wilderness temptation ends up being Satan showing him, the scripture says in verse 5, in a moment of time, all the kingdoms of the world. You can imagine how what that would be like. I will give you all this domain and its glory, for it has been handed over to me, and I give it to whomever I wish. Would there have been a temptation to Jesus with regard to this? Now, we know that he didn't fall prey to it, but would there be a temptation in this? To us it would, for sure. What was the main misunderstanding that the Jews had with regard to the Messiah?
That Jesus was going to come back to rule over earth.
In a physical way.
Yeah.
And not just rule over Israel, but to dominate all the Gentiles, dominate all of the nations. That's what the expectation was going to be. Putting that expectation together with this particular temptation, could that have been a temptation? Whew, boy, this is a shortcut. I can be a Messiah over the, and think of all the good I could do being the guy who's in charge of everything. But Jesus says no. Why? What was the price?
You have to give up the top priority, and that's serving God.
That's right. And you had to worship Satan. That was the price. I'll give you all this stuff if only you will bow down to me. Well, Jesus, of course, ends up once again quoting the book of Deuteronomy, this time chapter 6 and verse 13. Turn over there with me, if you will. Where it just very simply says, you shall fear only the Lord your God, and you shall worship him and swear by his name. That was the command. There weren't to be a number of gods that you were going to be worshiping. There was only to be one, and that is what Jesus ends up telling Satan. Could Satan really deliver on this particular claim, on this promise?
No.
The answer is kind of yes and no. Could he on a temporary basis? On earth. Could he in the long term? Not at all. Not at all.
The whole premise of what Satan, I think, was trying to accomplish, he succeeded with Adam and Eve.
Mm-hmm.
And he was trying to get in, to get Jesus, to shortcut Jesus' goal.
Yeah. This would be a way to undercut the entire plan of salvation for a wide range of reasons.
Well, Satan was willing to lose this battle to win the war.
Yeah, good way of putting it. This would be a way to win the war. Going back to Revelation, what is the dragon trying to do to the woman with child? Destroy him. He's standing right in front of the woman who's in labor so that he can gobble up the child. And this was an attempt to gobble up the child. That's what this was. Exactly. So, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Jesus' response once again ends up being to do what? Reason with Satan? Yeah, he just comes back with Scripture, doesn't he? What does that teach us, by the way? We're going to see this again, FYI, with the third temptation. What does this end up teaching us? Yeah. Or that maybe temptations can oftentimes be thwarted, or to use a swordsman sort of a thing, can be parried, right? With Scripture, that we can potentially do that by reading Scripture and knowing it. So then how important does reading Scripture become? Super important. This just comes after years of ministry, but one observation of ministry, just watching people over a long period of time, is a lot of times people end up falling into temptation. You know why? They don't know any better. Sometimes they just simply don't know. And when you end up, I think I may have told the story before, but there was a lady in the church in Manchester, this was a number of years ago, who learned the gospel and so I was doing follow-up teaching with her and that kind of thing. And she, we were going through, the list of that talk about these are sins. You know, that there are sin lists, especially in the New Testament. Don't do this, don't do that. And so because of the fact that quite frequently, biblical language, if you know what I'm trying to say, is a little bit foreign to the ear of people who aren't Bible readers. And so we ran across fornication. And I said, so what does fornication mean? And she said, I don't know. So I said, okay, well, let's take a look at what Scripture has to say. And so we talked about all the things that Scripture had to say with regard to fornication. And she said, oh, so I guess I shouldn't be sleeping with my boyfriend? I said, well, yeah. That caused a little bit of a kerfluffle in her personal life, but the point at least is that here she was, and she actually tried to justify it. Well, I won't say justify it, but she asked the question, because she was really a very sincere person. She said, but we love each other. Isn't that okay if we love each other? And I said, well, you know, it kind of depends. You kind of need to get married, you know. This needs to be a permanent thing if you're going to be sleeping with this fella. And she was like, whoa. This was all brand new information. Now, for us, if any of us, I think many of us might have been, you know, kind of raised in a church or in some sort of a moral environment, but this young woman had not. She'd been kind of raised in the hippie world to a large degree. So, you know, hey, if you love them, I'm not like being promiscuous or something. You know, this is like a permanent relationship after a fashion. We like each other. We love each other. So, okay, it's all right, right? No. And just kind of, you know, kind of piggybacking off of that, many times there's a lot of folks that do things that really aren't right. Why? Because they just don't know any better. Well, you suppose that could apply to any of us? Sometimes it does, when we haven't really thought about what some of these commands might really mean or how they end up applying. What does it mean to lie, for example? What does it mean to gossip? What does it mean, you know, what are some, we know what stealing means, but are there various ways to steal? Of course. And we just kind of could go down the line on things like that and ask ourselves those sorts of questions. And as we do, guess what happens? We start maturing. We start realizing, oh, there is something wrong with having this particular kind of a mindset. There is something wrong with having this kind of an attitude. There is something wrong with you know, some of these little things that I've thought were okay-ish. You know, maybe they weren't ethical or something, but they were okay-ish. And we end up, therefore, finding ourselves better armed to not disobey God. But it's only when we know what's being said. And that's why it is that Jesus, I think, is providing for us a wonderful example. Every time he gets tempted, bang, here comes the scripture. Get tempted again, bang, here comes the scripture. And I'm obeying God. That's what I'm doing. That's what his attitude was about things. Exactly. And you are getting just a wee bit ahead, but it's a very incredibly important point, especially as we're kind of running out of time here, that we do notice that even Satan sometimes quotes scripture. What does that tell us? Give me an example of times, sometimes whenever Satan might quote scripture. There's tons of them in our world today. God is love. Love one another. As that is being interpreted or understood in our modern day society, what has that gone to justify in many cases? Homosexuality? All kinds of things. You know, because the big argument all the time among the homosexual community is love is love. Well, what they've done basically is they've conflated or merged the idea of love with sex. That's what's happened. Is God love? Yes. Should we love one another? Yes. But love as defined by God, not as defined by what the world has to say about it. There you are. So there's this. Or how about salvation is by faith? Isn't that what the scripture says? And now quote it, right? But the question is that the S-U-M of scripture? Or is that just the S-O-M-E of scripture? So the point basically being is that, you know what? You can take this book and you can make the attempt to try to prove just about anything under the sun you want to, as long as you get the privilege of defining the terms, or of, if you know what I mean, cutting out certain...
The church is one foundation, is Jesus Christ her Lord. She is...